Hey guys, and welcome to the video. Today I will talk about unit testing of deep learning code. Specifically, I will talk about a technique called mocking. Let me quickly explain what mocking is in my own words. Mocking is a way how one can take real objects, for example, Python classes, and replace them with so-called mock objects to replicate or to imitate the behavior of the original object slash class. What you see here is the official Python documentation, and namely, it is the unit test mock module. You can find all the relevant details on mocking here, even though it's probably not the best first read if this is new to you. For our purposes, the most important section is here, which describes the mock class. And what I would like to point out is that the mock class is accepting multiple different keyword arguments. And the one that we're going to be using extensively is the spec argument, because it will allow us to replicate a behavior of a neural network without actually using that neural network. That's it for the spoiler. And let's just start with the coding. I will implement a game where we are given a sentence with one blank word, and our goal would be to guess what the most likely missing word is based on a list of suggested words. And if we get it right, we win, and if we don't get it right, we lose. So specifically, let's say we're given the following input sentence: hello, mask. And here the mask represents the missing word. And also we will be given, let's say, three different choices. So Earth, Day, and World. And our goal would be to pick one of them, write it in the standard input, and then let the program evaluate whether it was correct or not. All right, so let me create a Python script. Let's call it app, for example. As you can see, I imported transformers because we will use it to get a pre-trained model and a tokenizer. Then I imported torch and numpy to do array tensor operations. And finally, I imported the sys module from the standard library, and this one will be used to create a minimalistic command line interface. Now we would like to implement the function that does all the work. Okay, so as you can see, the getTopK function expects a sequence, which will be a sentence with a missing token in it. Then we need to provide a tokenizer and a model. Both of them will be coming from the transformers package. Regarding the model, we don't have to worry about any fine-tuning whatsoever, because mass language modeling is actually one of the two tasks that the bird model is pre-trained on. And finally, we have the parameter k that represents the top k results that we want to return. What this function returns is a one-dimensional tensor representing the indices of the top tokens that are the most likely to fill in the missing word. All right, so let me start the implementation. First of all, we want to tokenize our sequence. And also we want to make sure that we are using PyTorch tensors. And what is returned is a so-called batch encoding that behaves more or less like a Python dictionary. What we're trying to do here is to find the position of the mask token, and we are making an implicit assumption that it is there and it's there only once. Here we do the forward pass with our language model using the batch encoding outputted by our tokenizer. Once we get the result, we access the logits attribute. So now we take our logits and we access the first sample. Know that the batch we are dealing with here has only one sample. And then we access the index corresponding to the mask token. And finally, we broadcast over the entire third dimension. And this way we will get a tensor of size equal to the vocabulary size, which I believe is something over 30,000. And then we take this tensor and we find the top k elements in it. And then just return it. And we will now use this function to implement the game. First of all, we disable logging so that we are not getting too many messages from transformers. We imported the tokenizer and the model. This line implements our small command line interface where we pass an argument and it will be seen as the input sequence. We run our function to get the indices of the top five most likely missing words, and then we decode them to get tokens. We retrieve the most likely token that was missing, and then we print out of the standard output the top five tokens. We then let the user guess which one of them is the most likely one. And finally, we just print out the results. All right, so let's just try the game out. So as you can see, we need to download the model, and that is because it is the first time we are using it and there is no local cache. All right, so who do I think is the winner? I wish I did more when I was younger. Let's see. Ah, I lost. The correct answer was new. Well, that's an interesting answer, but yeah, why not? Anyway, it seems like our game is working correctly. Let's run the game one more time. However, this time, let's also time it. As you can see, it took around 8 seconds to run this, if I round down, because I also needed to write new into the standard input. And the reason why it takes 8 seconds and it's not faster is because we need to instantiate the tokenizer and the model and load them in memory. Anyway, let's say that now we would like to write a unit test for the getTopK function. So let me start off by creating a test script. And let me import a couple of things. Now let us write two different unit tests. The first one will be working with real objects, specifically the tokenizer and the model that we load from transformers. And the second one is going to be using the mock object. For simplicity, let's say that we are just trying to make sure that whatever the getTopK function returns is a torch tensor and that it has the right shape. So as you can see, this is very similar to our script, because we load the actual tokenizer and model, and then we take a real sequence and run the getTopK method, and then we just simply check whether the result is a torch tensor and that it has the correct shape. We also try it out for multiple k so that we know that it is really working. Let me try to run the tests. As you can see, the tests are passing. However, it takes around 5 seconds to run each of them. That is caused by the fact that we are re-instantiating the model and the tokenizer with each test. Let me also point out that the models are already cached and downloaded, so there is no need to re-download them again. Now we would like to write a second test that is not using any of the real objects like the tokenizer and the model, and instead it tries to imitate them by using the mock class. Before we start writing the test itself, let's just first try to understand what types we are dealing with. The quickest way to do this is to just put a breakpoint inside of our game and investigate the objects dynamically. Let's check where we are. First of all, let us check what the type of our tokenizer is. So as we can see, it is a BERT tokenizer fast. Then let's do the same thing for the model. And let's also see what the tokenizer is returning when we call it. And lastly, let us also check what is the mask token ID. So now we have more or less all the information we need, and we can go back to implementing the test. Let me import all the classes that we saw in the debugger. Additionally, we also want to import the mock class from the standard library. And now we are ready to start writing the test. First of all, let us define a sequence, even though it's not necessary. We also define a vocabulary size, which in our case can be anything. Here we define a batch encoding that is returned by our tokenizer. However, we are not including things like attention mask and others because for the purposes of the getTopK function, having the input IDs is enough. When it comes to the actual values of input IDs, in our case, it doesn't really matter what you put inside as long as the mask token ID is in there. Here, I tried to make the input IDs more realistic by adding 2 extra tokens, one representing the classification token and the other one representing the separator token. However, it's not necessary. Here we define logits using random numbers. And the reason why we do that is because our test is only going to check for length rather than the correct order of the results. Here, finally, we use the mock class. And first of all, we want it to behave like the BERT tokenizer fast, so we specify it as a spec. Then we also specify a return value, which represents the value that is going to be returned when we call this mock. And finally, we define that there is an attribute mask token ID and that it's going to be equal to 103. Here we define our second mock, and this one is imitating the behavior of the BERT for masked language modeling class. Here we finally use the logits that we defined above, and we hook them up to the return value of the model under the attribute logits. Finally, we use the getTopK function and we provide our mocked objects as inputs. And here we just copy-paste the assert statements from the previous test. Let's run the tests now, but let's just make sure we remove the breakpoint that we created. As you can see, the two tests that were using real objects took more than 5 seconds each. However, the tests that were using mock objects were basically immediate. To summarize, let me point out three things that mocks allowed us to achieve. First of all, we were able to have faster tests. Second of all, we did not have to worry about downloading a pre-trained model on our disk. And third of all, we don't have to worry about loading a huge model in memory. And all of this is really important, especially in a case where you have a continuous integration setup and you probably care about speed and you probably care about the amount of resources you're using. On the other hand, there are a couple of negatives when using mocking. First of all, it can totally happen that the real objects and the mock objects behave differently. And therefore, if you are testing only with the mock objects, you might miss some bugs that exist with real objects. And second of all, arguably setting up mocking is not necessarily easy and it might make the code more complicated than working with real objects. All right, that's it for today. And I really hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned a lot of new things. And if you want me to continue creating content like this in the future, please subscribe and like this video.